narcissistic.
Was that pre-Red Book?
Pre-Red Book. You can see certain narcissistic, pre and post, because he allowed it in the collected work. You see stylistic things where you wish Jung wouldn't be quite so much the male knower, quite so much the pompous prophet and that kind of thing that you can see him playing. But, you know, that's so... superficial a reading of Jung, and you don't judge any book by its cover, including the Red Book, beautiful as the cover is. But when you go into the Red Book, I defy anybody who reads that not to feel the amazing integrity of the man, not just the brilliance or the courage and fortitude of the man, but just the willingness to engage and let himself be instructed, just the fact that he's so willing in that book to put his considerable knowing. When he knew so much before he started, he knew he needed to find his soul, and he knew she would be a she. He knew a lot before he even started. And he sort of knew this self-experiment could mean something, but he ends up putting his knowing in the service of his experiencing. That's what he does with Salome, and then within the whole thing, finally to realize that the figures are talking through him and he voicing him rather than he voicing them, and meets the parts of himself, takes up whatever position is necessary. You can see him if you study psychological types as I do. It's not hard to see Jung changing his own psychological type in order to get the benefit of a real conversation with the person, yet never losing the integrity of his will to stay present but authentic in relation to. It's absolutely staggering that a person can both decenter his identity, hold on to it at the same time, and is willing to literally turn himself inside out. So you later get concepts like psychotherapy is done through the inferior function. This really shows what that means. That, I mean, he goes, I mean, of all the anima figures, as I've said publicly, to choose, well, why Salome? I mean, he was ashamed that it was Salome. I mean, it was kind of a shameful figure from the Bible who asked for the head of John the Baptist. But you can sort of see him just nevertheless saying, well, if that's my soul, then I'm going to have to learn from her. And it's not up to me. I said I would open myself up to my soul.
And ask for beheading.
He does.
Yeah.
He does. He lets her... He lets himself have an experience, but never in the midst of all that does he finally succumb to just a romantic dissolution a la Nietzsche or someone else or many other people. That it's very different. He's learning when he can, and when he finally realizes that these figures aren't going to save him, that only he can save himself, he always comes up with the most amazing sanity, with a certain sense of his own limits and a certain sense of what he can do, which turns out to be cultivate his own garden, as we were talking about.
Okay.
The book is almost as rational as it is irrational, and that's part of the thrill of it, is that he's able to somehow be both, and he's able to be so many different things. Once you experience it, it's a perfect example of what I mean by integrity and depth.
Yeah.
And so you don't worry about Jung's moodiness or his narcissism or his... what you begin to realize is that this was a man who both as a therapist and as a person, had a very strong need to be a Christian hero, and that Christian heroism was very different from the kind of heroism that would be represented by a figure like Siegfried, who's killed early by Jung, and in that digression into the medical power trip that he had gone on with Freud. That was not a true hero for Jung, and he saw the flaw. So he overcomes that kind of self, and then he goes in a Christian way. You hear it in Christians outside of Jung, that which God presents, that I will do. Well, he takes that into the inner world, and whatever the inner world presents, he will follow that. And then in a marvelous way, having overcome himself to that degree with following the law of love, he then realizes that there's also a limit to how far he can go their way.
Mm-hmm.
And that then he overcomes his own self-overcoming, mm-hmm. which is the exquisite, mm-hmm. amazing second movement of mm-hmm. the thing. And so he's just back to a standpoint. I suppose if I had only one criticism of Sonu's magnificent edition, which could not have been done better, but Sonu had to piece together certain portions of the notebooks to complete the book. I think I would have stopped about a paragraph earlier than Sonu stopped, where Jung says, "I'm just left with myself."
Mm-hmm.
And he has some wonderful phrases about this terrible, squalling, nasty thing, myself. And I thought, if it had stopped there, it would be one of the truly great 20th century novels.